So once bitten, twice shy. If you've been through a separation before, it's pretty normal to be extra cautious when you enter your next one. So today we're going to go over how you can protect your assets in your next relationship. So tell me, Nardine, how do we do it? How do we protect our assets?
Well, you want the good news or the bad news?
Yeah.
Look, there really isn't a way to do it except
stay single.
Yeah. No, you don't. Can't do that. It's always good to go again and again.
Fifth marriage round.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah. Good for us anyway. So look, a financial agreement is really the only way, and that's what we used to call a prenup. It's exactly the same concept. You enter into a financial agreement which sets out how you're going to divide your assets in the event of your separation. And that financial agreement can be before you start a de facto relationship. It can be during the relationship. It can be during the marriage. So that is really the only way. So what people do is they, in their agreement, they say, I brought a house into this second marriage. If we separate, the house is mine. It's not there to be divided between the two of us. That sort of stuff. So there's a lot of controversy about financial agreements and whether they are binding as we all thought they were going to be. Seems as if the court does look for ways to try and set these financial agreements aside. The problem is always when you're drafting one for a client, you're crystal ball gazing, you're trying to work out what's going to happen potentially, you know, 10, 20 years down the track. And it is really difficult to get a fair agreement in place when you're at the start of a relationship, because who knows what's going to happen. You draft the agreement as if people are going to be doing things equally, but that might not end up happening. There might be children that are born to the new relationship. So there's all sorts of reasons why a court looking at a financial agreement at the end of the second relationship might say, we don't think this is fair, and set it aside. Mm. But that's all you can do, really, and it's better than doing nothing at all. Yeah. So people ask, you know, can I just have the property in my sole name? Yes. Can I just have the money in my bank account? Yes. Can I gift something to somebody else? Yes. But none of these things are going to protect you if the matter is before the family court. Because the court doesn't care if the property's in your name.
No.
It'll still divide it if it considers that it should be part of the property pool. If you've gifted your property away to somebody else, you know, particularly to avoid a property settlement, the court will just look behind that transaction and bring the property back in to the pool. So, you know, there's really nothing you can do except have that financial agreement. And the only other thing really is to keep good records of what goes on over the time, if you think that you're going to need it, which is a pretty awful way to enter a new relationship.
Absolutely. But, hey, can we sit down and have a discussion? Yeah. Can you just sign this document?
Yes, that's it. But yeah, so get some advice before you start the new relationship.
Yeah.
Before you start putting money together and buying property together, have a chat to a lawyer about what you can do and how the property should be, in whose name and so on. And get that financial agreement is probably the best advice.
And look, usually, you know, if you've been through it once and you know, it's a smart thing to do,
I think.
For couples, especially if, you know, you've both left, you know, you're both on your second relationship together. Yep. I think both of you can have a mature discussion around it and not see the emotional side of it and just go, it's just a smart thing to do.
Yeah, sure. And, you know, the sort of agreement that people like is one where you keep what you brought in and anything that you buy together, you split.
Yeah, which is fair enough.
Yeah,
I like
that's
that.
Right.
So is there anything people should avoid doing then?
Well, probably doing what we were talking about before, you know, putting money into the name of auntie, you know, auntie someone who's, you know, trying to do things that are to defeat a property settlement. It's just not worth doing because, you know, any lawyer, you know, who knows what they're doing is going to take one look at a big bank statement with a $10,000 disappearing to somebody, and it's just not. There's no point doing it because it's just going to be brought back into the property pool. So
do it slowly.
Yeah. No. So don't do anything fraudulent. Yeah, do it slowly. Give it to me.
So what if two people are struggling to come to an agreement on their assets?
Come and talk to a lawyer. Go to mediation. That's always a good idea, is to try and get some agreement about your assets. If you're talking about how you're going to divide them in the event of a separation.
Yep.
Go and have a mediation, work that all through.
Yes. Love it. So protecting and managing your assets can be a complicated thing. However, don't let it stress you out and don't fear that you'll have a repeat of the events of your previous relationship as well. So if you need expert advice on this matter, don't hesitate to get in touch with the team at Collier Lawyers. They'd love to help you out.